spot right now.
Okay, great.
What's up, everybody? Woo! Man, I don't even need a mic. I'm loud enough. How's it going, guys?
Good.
Welcome to day two of Bell County Comic Con. You guys having a great time?
Yeah.
How crazy is this?
Crazy.
Oh, my God. Well, what's one of like, the coolest things you guys seen? Us, right?
Right.
Yeah. What's up? Okay, so, guys, welcome to today's panel. We are talking to Timothy Lim and Mark Pelligrini?
Pelligrini,
all right. So, these guys, look, in case you don't know, like, can you guys, like, tell us what all do you do, man? Like, what do you do?
You know that blonde girl you've been seeing all over the place at this show on the billboard and all the, the banners on your badges and your t-shirts and everything? That's Kamen America, and She's not the Noid. She's not Ronald McDonald or Max Knight. She wasn't created for the show. She's a comic book character that Tim and I created in our book Kamen America. We're up to issue 3, and issue 4 comes out in September. She's been used as the face of Bell County this year. But we're very proud of the character. She's been doing very well. Her book's been doing very well, and that's just one of the books that we've got coming out.
We've worked in the industry for 10 years. We actually started working in merchandising. So originally we were merchandising creators for Marvel, Lucasfilm, Hasbro, Transformers, Nickelodeon, and then we branched out to doing independent work. For the last four and a half years approximately, we've been doing some artwork for Bell County Comic Con. But during like last year, one of the things that happened was we had this unique opportunity because Iconic Comics was opened in Temple, Texas as a publishing company for comics. If you look at sales numbers for like Marvel and DC, your sales numbers are tanking while manga is increasing. So one thing that we're doing is we're trying to find out like what is a way that we can rejuvenate the independent comics market in kind of a way from learning in terms of how the Europeans and the Japanese do comics. So luckily that opportunity presented itself during everything that happened last year, and it just skyrocketed. We launched Kamen America on Kickstarter in January of last year. We raised $20,000. Kamen America 2 launched in the fall of last year, and we raised $70,000. We just finished Black Ops X Kamen America, which is our crossover book, and we just crossed $110,000. And our backer number keeps on rising, and so the opportunity has presented itself, and so we're just very fortunate that Bell County decided to not only sponsor Iconic Comics, but use Kamen America as the mascot character. The feeling is incredible, seeing people wearing the t-shirts, having the badges, the cups, all the merchandise that goes with it. All that groundwork was laid a decade ago, but it's only been within the last 4 years, and most specifically because of the hospitality of the citizens of Bell County and the surrounding area that we've been able to have the success that we've had. So it's really cool to be here.
So a question for you guys, like, when did you like realize, like, wow, I can draw really well, like, I have a great artist? Or like,
never, because I'm the writer, so I have no idea.
My day job, I'm an audiologist, so I never went to art school, never took art classes, nothing like that. I'm completely self-taught. We've gotten a couple of questions like that at our booth, people asking, what's some advice? My kid wants to be an artist, they want to draw, which college should I send them to? And I think they're shocked, because I'm like, I never went to art school, I just kind of did it as a hobby. And in fact, most of the people that we hire for commissions are Japanese. We hire them a lot of times through Instagram, and the average age is 18. And the reason why is because kids are growing up with digital tablets, and they grew up on manga, for example, from an early age, so that by the time they're 18, they're all really good at drawing, and none of them took art classes. It's just part of their culture, is that you just practice every day, you do it for fun, and so that's the advice I would give people. Now, I'm not saying that that works 100% of the time. I think there are some times where art classes are good to take, but you have YouTube, and there's a lot of free ones out there, so that's essentially... Bob Ross, that's a classic. So believe it or not, I'm not good at drawing backgrounds. So what I did was I took old Bob Ross YouTube videos and I just did the same thing except in Photoshop. So when he says like, oh, I just take this palette knife and make these pretty little trees, I go in Photoshop and go like palette knife. Oh my gosh, it works digitally too. It's the same thing. And so
you use clouds to cover all your mistakes.
Exactly, use clouds to cover all your mistakes. Use a lot of whiteout for snow. That's my general advice, is that a lot of people want to go like the university route, and trust us, we both work for universities, that's not always the best route. In fact, you can bypass that if you have a strong portfolio with the work.
Mark, you said you were a writer.
Okay.
Like, what are were some influences like that, or what got you started? Like, man, I have a story to tell, and I'm gonna tell it well.
Well, I mean, writing is fun. It's something that's you gotta do every day if you wanna get better at it. I mean, just like playing the violin or drawing, you've gotta practice every day. I really love writing just because I write novels, I write short stories. I've had them published in Cursiva magazine and places. Some of my books are on Amazon, that kind of stuff. I like writing different kinds of formats, though. I mean, I'll write some. The way you write a short story is different from the way you write a novel. The way you write a comic script is different from a screenplay. And it's important to try out all the different formats, all the different ways you can write. That's how you learn the different mixed media kind of things. A comic script, what I discovered, ended up being the most challenging because there is no academic format for writing a comic script. Everyone does it differently. You'll find some tutorials out there for, say, like the Marvel method that Stan Lee used. And the Marvel method is Stan Lee would write a summary of the issue, then he would give that to the artist, and the artist would extrapolate the plot from the summary, and they would draw their pages out. And then they would give them back to Stan Lee, and Stan Lee would essentially caption in the dialogue and the narrative text and things like that. And that's a very different way of writing a script from anything else that most people are used to when it comes as a writer. You know, it's very different from writing prose, it's very extremely different from writing a screenplay. But that's the unique thing about comics, is that it's a collaborative medium, it's a visual medium. So as long as you're collaborating directly with your artist and you develop a style of script writing that is appealing and suits with your artist, that works with them so they can interpret it to the best of their artistic abilities so that you're both on the same page, then you make a style of writing that is unique to you. It's a format that's unique to you. It's not academic. It's something that's the way Brian Michael Bendis writes a script. I'm not saying I like Brian Michael Bendis, but the way he writes a script is very different from the way Alan Moore writes a script, which is totally different from the way Stan Lee wrote a script, and is all very different from the way Mark Pelligrini writes a script. It's something that's totally up to you and how you work with your writer. And that's something that's very fun and very rewarding, especially in comics, is that you get to do something that Stephen King doesn't get to do when he's writing short stories and novels. And it's not something a screenwriter in Hollywood gets to do because they are constrained with what the academic format is. Comics are a unique, even as a writer, they're a unique expression of how you write. And it's just very, very fun.
So, like, when you wrote your first story, like, what inspired your first character that you, like, wrote?
So, if we're talking, like, in comics...
USAGI.
Yeah, USAGI.
I like rabbits. Yeah. And because my wife and I have rabbits, we have 5 rabbits, and they always say to write what you know, and I know rabbits. So, one thing that Mark and I have in common is that we like G.I. Joe. Like, we grew up reading G.I. Joe comics, and as I was mentioning before, we're looking at the declining sales numbers, Marvel, DC... IDW has declared bankruptcy like 2 times, and a lot of times it's hard to determine like what is it that makes something sell versus not, and it really just boils down to how good is the story. And so from our perspective as readers, it's like we kind of know what is missing in it. And part of like G.I. Joe is it's a real American hero that everyone remembered as kids in the 80s, like, oh my gosh, yo, Joe. And so we're like, why don't we play on hard mode? Let's say, what if we could make a book that was better than G.I. Joe, but with the most depowered character ever. So we created this character named USAGI, and if you have the children's badge that has the rabbit on it, that's him. That was our first independent character. And the story about it is during an atomic bomb blast, this rabbit was caught in it, and he was given like a heightened intelligence, so he can't talk like a human can, he can't think like a human can, but he's very smart, almost like, just think of like the smartest dog or gorilla you can think of. He's at the peak of like animal intelligence. And if you think about it, a rabbit's very unassuming. You know, if you're a terrorist and let's say a canine comes after you, you're gonna be scared. But if you're sitting there and a little fluffy rabbit comes after you, you're like, oh, what is this? But the rabbit, if he knows how to wield a knife or throw a grenade or something, he can really mess things up. So that was the character that we came up with, and it was based on what we know. Mark knows how to write kind of a patriotic character. I know how to write rabbits, and I know how to draw rabbits. And so we did that. We don't claim to be savants. I'm definitely not the best artist. Mark might be the best writer in his mind, but
absolutely,
we know our limitations, and we know that we can put it together and make something that's entertaining. And so that was our first breakout hit. was we did something based on what we were comfortable with.
And so you said that was your first big, what year was this?
2000 and, my gosh, 17.
Yeah.
Hi. And was that your first publication, or when were y'all first published?
We were first published, technically, it was Back to the Future number one. I did that in 2000, it was the anniversary of Back to the Future, so it was 2015, yeah. That was the first time we got cover work in comics, even though we've been working in merchandising since 2011, so lost in time, yeah.
Oh man, I'm telling you, like this past year, time just kind of
blurred
together.
It's so crazy.
During this pandemic, like what did you guys do? With what you guys do for work, like right. It's just, were you just like, now I have all this
we
time,
have a lot of
no
time.
Distractions, I can focus and start.
And that's what we did.
Building these new and.
Last year, so we did Kamen America, Kamen America 2, Black Ops. Black Ops is a 72-page book. Kamen America is a 56, 64-page book. So we did 220-something pages. And there's only two people. It's just me and him. I do all the art, the colors, the inking, and the pencils, and the lettering. And he writes the scripts and the edits. So it's a two-man job. It's just two of us. And we put out 250 pages. Meanwhile, there's industry pros who can't put out 64-page books. And they complain all the time, like, why is the industry tanking? It's like, the culture of what happens in the companies needs to change. The mangaka, there's literally, I don't encourage anyone to do this, please do not do this. A lot of manga artists, they literally die from exhaustion because they work all the time. They do nothing but draw all day. And there's some days where, honestly, I've been having some health problems recently because I kind of do the same thing. But it's like, no, during this terrible time where everyone's locked down and you're quarantined, what you do to try and thrive and survive is you do what most people did, which is you find ways around it. And I said, we have a lot of downtime. Let's just keep on making pages and crank them out and stuff like that. So that's kind of what we did during this whole ordeal.
Now I was going to say, I mean, it's all about the most important thing is if you make a deadline, that's a promise, and you have to keep that promise, even if it means that you go through a lot of crunch time, because maybe you underestimated your deadline, and so now like, oh, I've got to get all these pages done, and there's only 48 hours left. Well, then I guess you're not sleeping because you made that promise, and you've got to fulfill it. And just since the 90s, the idea of the deadline and meeting it and making your print on time has just sort of gone away as part of comics culture. People, you know, just since the 90s have said like, well, late comics are just, you know, the norm or something like that. That's not the way it used to be. Back in like the 70s, you know, if you ever picked up a Marvel Comics reprint from like the 70s, like a trade paperback that's a complete collection, you'll see like a cover with no issue attached to it. That's because it was a reprint of a previous issue because they didn't make their deadline for the month. And they're like, well, we're not going to miss publishing an issue of Ghost Rider for this month, so they're going to do an archive. They're going to grab an old issue, reprint it for that month, and they would stamp an apology on the first page saying, we're sorry that we missed our deadline. Please enjoy this classic issue of Ghost Rider this month. We'll have a new story next month. The idea of missing a deadline was humiliating, and they had to just beg you, you know, not to stop reading the book. Because that was the conditions back then. And that's the way it still is in a lot of countries like Japan and a lot of European nations where comics are still very big, is that if you miss a deadline, it's a source of shame. But the culture changed in the United States, and now just books come out when they come out. And that's it makes a lot of people, it's unreliable, it makes a lot of people just not trust comics. You know, you subscribe to books at your local, you know, comic shop, and you just don't know when the next issue is going to come out. And, you know, a preview says it's going to come out in November, and then it comes out in, like, March of the next year. Or if you're doing a crowdfund book, and it's you promise it's going to come out this month, this year, and sometimes years go by and they don't get their book out of time. And it's not just crowdfund comics, no video games on Kickstarter and a lot of other things like that. People underestimate their fulfillment dates. But you just have to know that a deadline is a promise, and the way you build goodwill and trust with your customer base is keeping your promises.
How many of you read manga here?
Yeah, everybody.
The manga, like Shonen Jump, that's a weekly. So that means that, for example, if you have the Shonen Jump app, which is $1.99 a month, you are getting almost a week's worth of content. And it's always on the clock, and they have editors writing them all the time to make those deadlines. And I look at that, and it's inspiring, because it's like these people, it's nose to the grindstone, they're just doing page after page, and they have an army of assistants that help them too. But that's a dedication, and it's a great shame to them when they can't make that deadline. I mean, everything is to the last minute. And I just think that that's one thing that a lot of American creators could learn from, is put your nose to the grindstone. He has a day job, I have a day job, and yet we put out more content than, like I said, a lot of like comics pros who are in the United States. And we're not doing that to toot our own horn. We're telling people, you can do this, you just have to work. And it's exhausting, don't get me wrong. Like, for example, last night, y'all, I mean, this convention has been great, but our team at Iconic Comics, they ran out of over 300 prints from yesterday alone. So last night at 1 o'clock, we emergency called the printer and said, we said, we need 300 prints by 8 o'clock in the morning. And we did it. So while my wife and everyone else was sleeping, I was there typing up, making phone calls, reformatting pages, and that was it. Whereas, like I said, we kind of joked about it because we just thought if this was some other people, they'd be like, I'm done, you know, I'm gonna go take a break. But you work at it. That's the only way you're gonna be able to not only make your customers happy, but you have to make those deadlines ultimately is what it comes down to.
Now, Tim, you said earlier, like, whenever they mentioned Bob Ross, they're like, oh, let me use that same tool. Like, wow, it works.
Yeah.
Do you prefer, like, you know, you just pen and paper, or do you prefer, like, using technology with the whack of boards or, like,
right,
the touchscreen computers?
I do everything almost 100% digital. The only time I do it traditional is at conventions because people like original art, and so they'll commission some original art pieces, and then I can do it traditional. I do everything for people interested in the technology. I use everything's done on an iPad, and I use a $4 program called Procreate. So 100% of everything, all the batch art that you see that I did the artwork for, that was all done on an iPad. You can buy a bigger tablet that'll cost you about $200. Adobe Photoshop costs you $800 unless you pay the subscription fee, which I think you have to nowadays. And then obviously you have the cost of your Mac or your PC. But luckily, there's so many drawing programs out there that you can use whatever is at your disposal to accomplish your end goals. Now, that's just me. The other two artists that we have at the table downstairs, Alejandro Mirabal and Matt, Alejandro does both, so he'll do traditional and digital. Matt is 100% traditional. If you want to see something, don't tell him I told you this. If you want to see something cool, he's going to kill me if he finds out. So Matt is a human printer. There's only a few people in the world who can do it. One of them is Kim Jung-ji in Korea, and the way we call his name is Master Kim, because what he can do is so astonishing that he has like almost a revered status. He doesn't have to pencil. You just tell him to draw something, he can draw it straight out of his brain to the paper using a pen, and he can do it. Matt Weldon is the American Kim Jung-ji. I've shown it to several people who don't believe me. You know, we'll have friends come in and say, hey, Matt, do that party trick. And he's like, I don't want to do it. I was like, come on, here's a Sharpie. Like, let's do it. He's like, draw Saitama. And he'll be like, okay. And it's the strangest thing. He's a human printer. He will just draw a full figure without having to erase or make any changes or anything like that.
It's like that scene from Aliens with Bishop.
It's like, with the knife. Like, oh, my gosh. And that's how Matt Weldon is. And he's so humble, though, that he doesn't show off that skill unless, you know, you go up and say, hey, I heard that you can do something. He'll do it for you because he's such a nice guy. But he likes doing traditional. The benefit to it is the downside is it's slower, because if you mess up, you have to work with it traditionally. The plus side is you can sell the original art, and that's how he makes a lot of his money. Is after he does it, he can, you know, charge a premium on it because it's an exclusive. Whereas me, I have no original art to sell, so there's no original Kamen America pages. It's all digital.
Oh goodness, What project or what piece took the longest to work on? What took, like, just forever to make?
It would have to be the Black Ops books, because those are 74 pages, and that takes about 2.5 months of work. He sends the script to me, it takes him about 3 weeks to flesh it out, we go back and forth, and then I'm off to the races. And so what I do is I try to work in a 5 to 8 hour day, and that's from penciling, inking, coloring, lettering. Will typically take me 8 hours during the day. We are cheating though, because my wife and I don't have kids currently, so obviously that does play a big role into it. But there are times when, you know, I'll come home from work and it's 5 o'clock and I don't want to work on anything, but I said, I have to get that page done. So let's just burn the midnight oil. Wife and I have a nice dinner, maybe sit down for an hour, watch a movie or TV, and then I'm off to the races to do that. Those Black Ops books take forever because they're just so voluminous in terms of how many pages we have.
Sometimes I feel guilty. So the way we work in tandem is that while Tim is drawing one book, I'm scripting the next one. So as soon as Tim is done drawing that book, I'm done scripting that one, and so I pass it off to him, and he just doesn't get a break. I think it was during Black Ops 3, we were talking, and he was like, there's no light at the end of the tunnel.
Just
like,
how many rabbits do I have to draw? Game over, man.
Game over, man. goodness. Do we have any like hobbyists or like any like aspiring artists here? Like, do you guys, anyone? Yeah? Yeah? All right. What's some advice that you guys would give to
aspiring creators? Yeah. It sounds really cliche, but it is practice. So there's he's kind of a pop psychologist. His name is Malcolm Gladwell. And what he did was he did this kind of long-term study where he looked at people who are considered experts in their field. And that includes athletics, so professional athletes, engineers, welders, blue-collar job workers, etc. And he calculated what is the number of hours to get to mastery. And the way he defined mastery is a task that you can just do, and it's automatic. You don't even have to think about it anymore. And the magic number was 10,000, which meant that was the number of hours that a human being has to put into some task to achieve it. And the funny thing is that I don't calculate my hours. All I know is that there was a time when I was working in merchandising, the first week on the job, they said, welcome to our company. This is how it works. You have to do 5 designs a week. You have to have a design ready by the end of the day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. If you do not have a design ready by the end of the week, you're gone. You're fired. That's just how it works. They're like, can you do it? And at the time, I thought, no, I can't even color. And it's like, well, you're going to have to learn fast. And so I did. I just learned how to work really quickly. It was this idea of, it doesn't matter how good it is, time yourself. You only have until the end of the day to finish it. Just get it out there. And I would just be stressing out because I thought, oh, I don't know how to draw a hand. I don't know how to draw hair. I don't know how to draw any of this stuff. And I just remember at one point, I never had to worry about it anymore. I just thought, it's like, draw a hand, make sure that they're doing this fist. And it's like, okay. And I just remember there was a time where my wife was like, you don't have to look at references anymore. And I thought, oh, I don't. And I just always remembered that Malcolm Gladwell number. And I thought, did I hit that 10,000 mark already? Like, I already put 10,000 hours of just drawing straight that you just learn from it. So that's my only advice that I can really give to artists, is that it really does boil down to putting the manpower and hours.
What about writing, just practice? Or?
It's the same thing. So with writing, I know that I talk to a lot of people, and just like them, I have a day job too. I mean, there's 40 hours a week where I can't do any writing because I'm doing my day job. And I know a lot of folks, their issue is that like they just don't have the time, like they want to write, but you'll never get better if you don't do it, is the thing. We've had friends of ours who are aspiring writers. They tell us the stories they want to tell, and we ask them, okay, so how much of the script have you written? And they say, nothing. And we ask them why, and they'll tell us things like, well, I don't have the time, or some people have told us that, like, well, no one's offered to pay me to write it yet. Like, well, no one's gonna offer to pay you to write it until you actually publish something. It's like, you know, one of those catch-22s. It's like, well, no one's gonna pay for your book unless you publish something, but no one's gonna publish your book unless you publish something, so. But you'll never get any better unless you practice and you write every day, whether someone's paying you to do it or not. And if it comes down to finding the time, well, even if it's just 1 hour a day, if you spend 1 hour a day at the gym, then you're 1 hour stronger than you were yesterday. If you spend 1 hour a day writing, you're 1 hour better than you were yesterday as a writer. And I wake up an hour early before I would normally have to go to work. I do some writing then. I have my lunch break. I do some writing then. I get home from work. I eat dinner. I do some writing then. And then I have the weekend. I know that I can produce more content if I was a full-time writer, but I'm not. So that means every hour I'm not spending doing my day job, I'm doing it writing. And that's just what you have to do. And you're gonna get better at it. I mean, even if you do something like running a blog, right? It can be something like that, where you review comics, which is something that I actually do recommend people do, because that causes you to think analytically about the book itself. That causes you to look through the book of just whether, like, we all have that gut reaction of, well, do I like it or do I don't like it? Is this cool or does it suck? But you have to like, well, why is it cool or why is it not cool? Why do I like it or why do I dislike it? That causes you to think about the architecture of the storytelling. And once you can break down the architecture of the storytelling, you find the formula or you find the finesse of how they wrote a story that appealed to you. How did all the pieces tessellate and come together to create a very satisfying narrative? And you don't necessarily have to go and attend, classes on writing, workshops on writing. Sometimes you just learn by breaking it down yourself, by studying the work. And the easiest way to do that is to just have a blog or a YouTube channel or whatever they do now to review comics. That causes you to think analytically about them. And that you can teach yourself a lot doing that. And of course, if you're writing a script for your YouTube channel where you talk about the review, or you're writing an article for your blog where you talk about the review, talk about the comic, well, then you're writing and you're getting your hour or two in a day, you're getting your practice in, and you're learning at the same time. So you can find the time to do it. You know, it doesn't have to be sitting down for 6 hours at a stretch and writing. Sometimes it's just an hour here and there, but you just have to make the time to do it.
Tim, Mark, is there anything that I missed or anything that you guys want to, like, just mention? Or I tell you what, what's something that you guys are working on now that you kind of want to, like, give a shout out to or, like, get a preview,
sure.
Like, exclusive here?
Well, yeah, so the exclusive is this. This is what we've been telling people. So a lot of people don't know Kamen America because it's an independent character. Most people on the internet who follow comics, crowdfunding, like Kickstarters and Indiegogo, they know who we are. We're very thankful for them. We had one gentleman, he drove 16 hours from Wisconsin yesterday.
What?
Just to meet us. It was the craziest thing. So all the guys, we just hooked him up with free stuff. Because we were like, we are so grateful that you
cover
came
down
here. Cover your gas to get home. Sell some books if you have to. But I think one of the neat things is, so most people, you got a book when you came in. It was, they only printed 10,000 of them, and they gave them to free to the attendees. If you look on the inside, there's a Kamen America comic in there. It's about 4 pages. So that's the Webtoons Kamen America that's going to be launching in September. You get it first here, so you get to see it before we go live on Webtoons in September. So I've been telling people, we've had some people come by, and it's like, we want your autograph so we can flip it, because we know Kamen America goes for $80 on eBay. And we have your signature. And you want the signature on that one, because when it goes live on Webtoons, you can sell on eBay and be like, you can read it through my book before anyone else gets to see it worldwide. You get it here at Bell County Comic Con. So we're gonna do web. It's another thing where I'm just like, when I see some of these independent creators who are like, they're basically work for Marvel, DC, or Image, they're like, oh, it's so taxing doing 64 pages a year. Like, how do you do it? I'm just like, we have day jobs. I'm doing 250 pages a year on top of a weekly webcomic. Like, there's just no excuse. I just don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear the excuse of, oh, we can't get the work done. It's just not going to work. We are putting more work onto ourselves, one, because we like it, but two, we just see these opportunities. We know a lot of kids go on Webtoons because it's free. You get to read free comics. It's like, let's put out Kamen America for free. Let's have a series that kids will like, because it's a kids-friendly book. Our book was intended for all ages, so if you are 10 years or 12 years old and older, you can read our books. There's no language, there's no foul language, there's no nudity, there's no gore. Everyone can enjoy them. So you guys, if you have a copy of it, if you're one of the first 10,000 people to get it, you have the exclusive preview of Kamen America, the web series. We just finished Kamen America 4, that's going to launch in September of this year, and Kamen America 5, we're going to start on in about 2 weeks, and that's going to launch in January of next year. We're just going to keep the ball rolling.
Awesome, guys. I think that's our time. Guys, give it up for Mark and Tim. Go out to their booth out in Hall C and just...
Hall A?
Hall A.
The basketball stadium.
I'm lost. But yeah, go to Hall A, check them out. Thank you guys so
Autographs
much.
Autographs are free, so yeah. Make sure you get everyone down there too.
Alrighty, thanks guys.
Thank you. Have a good day, everybody.